shepherd, and he is everything I need. So I will not worry, I will not fear the enemy. He said that he loves me, he said that he's with me. Even though I walk through the valley of shadow and death, and still I know he has good. He has good plans for me. So I will take heart in deserts and gardens. He has good plans. He has good plans for me. If I know my Father, I know my Father. Good plans. Savior, so why should I doubt my victory? Why would I question the rod and the staff that comforts me? He quiets the waters, he quiets the storm inside of me. So what could be better?
Good morning. There we go. Got some lights. Welcome. Good to see you. Beautiful, sunny Memorial Day weekend. And we're so thankful. I was just talking with the team up here about family members, dads and uncles and aunts that have been in the military. I counted this week. I was with four friends, and we counted. I counted eight in my family. My grandfather on my dad's side was in World War I. On my mom's side, World War II, Vietnam, Korea. You know, eight of my grandfathers and uncles and aunts, and several up here we mentioned, and so many, way too many that gave the ultimate, gave their lives. But here we are in this place. We didn't have to fight to get here or go through a barricade or walk in from a tunnel. We came in just wide-eyed and wide open, out loud, praising God. Amen. And we just are so appreciative and thankful for that. We don't take it for granted, do we? We do not take it for granted. And this is the day that the Lord has made. Psalm 118 says, "Let's rejoice and be glad." And again in Psalm 100, "The Lord is good. His mercy endures forever. His faithfulness endures throughout all generations." Generation after generation after generation after, and on, and you get it. First Chronicles says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever." Stand with me. Father, we worship you this morning. In this day, help us to open our hearts and our minds to you. May your word be powerful. It is powerful, but may we hear it in a way that we would bring us understanding. And Lord, so we're praying that your Holy Spirit would reign here today in and through us, and that you would move and have your way with us, and we would be obedient and we would be humble in your presence. We thank you. We love you for your love and your mercy that endures forever and forever and forever. Amen. Let's worship him.
Now I can
today. Come and sing your praise, for the Lord now reigns on the throne of grace. And soon is the day He will bring us home, and we have this hope, for we are His own. Sing it out. Revelation 4, they're doing this in heaven now. At once I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven with one seated on the throne, and around the throne on each side are four living creatures, and day and night they never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to Him who's seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 34 elders fall down before Him and worship Him. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are You, O Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for You created all things, and by Your will they existed and were created. And we extol You, O King, our God, and bless Your name forever and ever. And on the glorious splendor of Your majesty," this is us today, "on the glorious splendor of Your majesty and on Your wonderful works, we will meditate." We meditate on Your love this morning, Lord. We think about, we intentionally come here this morning to be in Your presence as a people. And Lord, we want all that You have for us today. All that You have for us, as we lift Your praise, be glorified, be pleased. We love You, Lord. Amen.
I can't wait for eternity. Join the song they're already singing. Holy, holy, holy are You, Lord. Just to bow down before Your throne, see Your face, I'll cry out, because You're holy, holy, holy are You. Thank you. the song they're already singing. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Just to bow down before your throne, see your face, I'll cry out, because you're generations
falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. The highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above the law. Your thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above the law. And the ages cry, oh,
Good morning. Welcome to Trinity. We are so happy to have you today. Thanks for worshiping with us. If you're new or if you're a guest, please stop by the Connect Desk on your way out today. Fill out that Connect card that's in your bulletin. We have a free gift for you. We want to meet you. We can't wait to see you. Guys, we have another men's breakfast coming up for you on June 10th. It's a Saturday morning at 9 o'clock. Come have some bacon, pancakes, get to know other guys. But you also get to hear from Jim Harrelson. You guys are going to seek the Lord together. The last breakfast was awesome, so if you missed it, you got to be there this time, June 10th. We are excited to bring back Trinity Summer Nights again this summer. We're going to have four of them this year starting June 28th. We've got summer vibes happening, lots of food, bounce houses, games, family fun, ice cream, snow cones, all the good stuff. It's so much summer happening here at Trinity. Check out all four of those nights. We cannot wait to invite you and invite your neighbors. Come on out. This July, we have an awesome opportunity for the whole church to serve in Detroit. It's Detroit Immersion. It's July 14th through the 16th, and our student ministries is gonna be down there helping with Camp Restore, doing some projects and getting to know the people down there in Detroit. And also, we wanna invite the adults to come on out. Get signed up. You guys are gonna get to partner with Central Detroit Christian to do some amazing work in Detroit as well. We cannot wait to see how God's gonna move as we partner with these organizations this summer. Go get signed up now. Detroit Immersion is awesome. In 2 weeks, on June 11th, we have a very important congregational meeting. It's our 43rd year of Trinity. We cannot wait to invite all of you to join us at our annual meeting that morning. We're going to have one combined service at 10:30 here in the FLC, and then we're going to meet together directly after service to just talk business, but also celebrate all that we have seen God move and do at Trinity this year. Join us for annual meeting. If you're a parent and you want to stay with us, because we'd love for you to do that, we have childcare. So go online now and find that sign up and let us know that you're going to leave your kids with us, and we'll feed them too. We'll see you at annual meeting. If you would like to give this morning, you can do so very easily by going to our app or our website. And you can also give in our giving boxes in the gathering spaces. Thank you so much. Now we are going to start a brand new sermon series called The Gift of Sabbath.
Good morning. My name's Lori Gustafson, and my husband Greg and I have been at Trinity for about 7 years. We enjoy being part of this body of believers and have participated in a life group for much of that time, and also serve in student ministries and the college and career. Greg's involved in that, and with Central Detroit Christian. And I'll be reading first from Genesis, chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God finished his work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it God rested from all his work that he had done in creation. From Exodus, chapter 20, verses 8 through 11. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do your work, all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. And from Mark chapter 2, verse 27, and Jesus said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Lori. Good morning. Happy Memorial Day weekend. My name is Mark, and I have the privilege of being one of the pastors and opening up God's word today. And we're going to talk, as Dana mentioned in the video, about this spiritual practice that was front and center in the Old Testament, front and center in the New Testament, but has fallen into almost complete disuse in our modern secular culture. And that's the practice, the spiritual practice of Sabbath. And as we do this, I want to try to convince you today that the Sabbath is a gift from God that we need to open and explore and just see the beauty of it, and that it will do amazing things in our life. And to begin doing that, before we look at God's Word, I want to tell you a story to help us see the priceless value and what that looks like. And it's the story of a little bowl. We don't know much about the history of this bowl. It's up on the screen, but this bowl was crafted in the 1000s, like 1000, 1100, 10th century, 11th century in China. In this one prefecture, there was a guy who started to make these bowls, these ceramic bowls, and they became known as the Ding bowls. They were made, crafted in this beauty. It was white, whitish, with decorations around the outside. And the craftsmen who did this would put these bowls into the kiln, and they would come out super valuable. They were given to the imperial courts. They were given to the rich merchants. And this particular bowl, we don't know much about its origins, but we do, you can conjecture what happened. It's over 1,000 years old, this bowl. And I have one that I found in our house that's similar to it in lots of different ways. It has Chinese writing on the bottom, so I know it's authentic. And we paid $5.95 for this at an Asian grocery store, so it's similar. But similar size. This is actually a little bit bigger than the bowl you see up on the screen. But you can just imagine that this bowl was given to one of the kings, the emperors in China in this prefecture, 1100, and then they had it and they valued it, and it was amazing. And they gave it, when they died, they gave it to their children, and then that child died, and pretty soon, you know, generations have passed, and this bowl was passed from generation to generation. And then you can imagine at some point somebody down the line gave this as a gift to an ambassador from somewhere, and they treated it with value. And then at some point along the way, we do know that this bowl passed over to the New World. It went, was given to somebody, who knows how it happened, where it happened, why, but it was traveled over to the United States. And what we do know is this, that at some point, this bowl ended up in an attic, in somebody's apartment or house in New York City. And somebody from New York in 2007 went to a rummage sale, and they found this bowl, and they purchased it for $3 U.S. And they brought it home, and they put it on their mantle, and people that would come to their place would marvel at the beauty of this little bowl. And somebody a few years later in 2013 said, you know, you should find out where this bowl came from. Maybe it's valuable. And they had it appraised by somebody, and they found out that it was a Ding ceramic bowl, that there was only one other bowl like this in the entire world. And so they put it up for auction, and at Sotheby's auction 2013, this bowl up on the screen sold for $2.2 million. Can you imagine? So today I have a deal for you. I'm willing to part with this for only $1 million. And if you want that, I have five more at the house. But here's the thing, is this bowl, which was super valuable, the inherent value of this Ding ceramic bowl never changed. It only increased over time, but people lost track of that. They didn't know how valuable it was. They didn't realize that they were putting this bowl up in the attic in a box that had immense value. But then it was rediscovered. And so I want to try to help you see today that the gift of Sabbath is a gift that has seen better days in our culture. The gift of Sabbath is a gift from God that He gave to humanity that at times has been has fallen into disuse, has fallen into disrepair. We don't think of it the same way anymore. And in fact, probably, I would almost guarantee it, there's some in this room, when I said we're going to talk about Sabbath, you're like, I don't even know what that is. I've never heard of Sabbath, or maybe I've heard the word, but I don't know what it truly means. Some of you who are my age and older, you remember days in our country when Sabbath meant something, when all the businesses were closed on a Sunday. Do you remember this? Anybody? Lots of us, right? Now, we want to go to Chick-fil-A on Sunday, and it's not open. It's the only like restaurant in the world that's not open on Sunday, and we're like, this is so stupid. Why aren't they open on Sunday? I want them to... But it used to be like that all over the place. And I remember growing up, and you couldn't go shopping. You couldn't go to restaurants on Sunday. They were all closed. We would gather together as a family. We'd get ready for worship to go to church. And then we'd come home, and my dad and my brother and I would rest while my mom made dinner. And then after dinner, we'd let the dishes sit and we'd watch the Lions play on TV, or we'd watch the Tigers, or we'd just rest. It was a day where there weren't any soccer leagues. Can you imagine? No soccer practices and hockey and all that sort of thing. It was just a more chill, relaxed time of rest. And yet today we think, that seems insane. Why did that change so much? How is it that we can come to a place today where we don't even know what the word Sabbath means, and if anything, it just means something weird back in the past? Well, part of it is just in the late 20th century, the practice of Sabbath began to fade because as our country became more secular, the church's position in our culture faded, and all of a sudden, as secularism emerged, we felt like as a country, we have new freedoms. We don't have to submit to like these onerous rules that religion puts on us and the church puts on us. And you can do now whatever you want to do on Sunday. We're free to do anything, right? And some folks figure out along the way they could make a buck on Sunday. And so businesses began to open more and more. And now it's odd that they're not open. And so we fast forward to today in our era. And if I say the word Sabbath to somebody who's under 50, doesn't have a church background at all, you might not know anything about what that means. And so I want to answer the question, what is a Sabbath? So what is a Sabbath? And to answer that question, we have to go back all the way to the very beginning of the Bible, because it turns out this idea of Sabbath is one of the key themes in the entire Bible, and it begins in the beginning. It says in the beginning that God created, in Genesis 2, that God created everything. In 6 days, he made everything. And whether you take that as a literal 24-hour, 6 days, or symbolic of periods of time, or however you take that, the point is the same exactly from Genesis. The point is that God made everything. On the sixth day, he made humans as the pinnacle of his creation. And on the seventh day, it says he rested. On the seventh day, God finished his work that he had done. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed that seventh day and he made it holy, because on it God rested from all his work that he had done in creation. And it's fascinating, you think about this. If God created humans just before the Sabbath, and then he takes a Sabbath day, that means that the very first day that humanity was on the earth was a day of rest. We didn't start out having to just work ourselves to the bone. God wanted that time for us to be together with him. Now, fast forward to Exodus, to Moses, the Ten Commandments are given. And what we saw read or heard read in the fourth commandment, Exodus 20, is this: remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Now, holy has some negative connotations oftentimes in our culture. If you call somebody holy, oftentimes it's not a compliment. You're holier than now. It means like it's the person who gossips all the time. They're a church lady, gossips all the time, and then says, bless their heart a lot. Or a church guy. Nobody? You know this, right? Holy literally just means set apart. It means that somehow this day is set apart from the other days to be special. That's what the word holy means. And so he says in Exodus, 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath. The Hebrew word Shabbat. It's a Shabbat to the Lord your God. Literally that word Sabbath or Shabbat means to stop. To stop. So if you ask me what is a Sabbath, I'll give you a definition. Just a working definition. Keep this in your mind. This comes from John Mark Comer, who, one of my favorite modern authors, just done some brilliant stuff, helping us to think about and practice the Sabbath. He calls it a 24-hour time period set aside to stop, rest, delight, and worship. 24-hour period set aside for us to stop, rest, delight, and worship. And we're going to unpack those over the next few weeks. But consider for a moment, if you would, even that idea of a seven-day rhythm. When you think about how we mark time in our culture, how we mark the seasons, all of the ways that we mark time are rooted in what? Like the creation order. You think about a day, is 24 hours. How do we come up with this magic number of 24 hours? What is it? It's how long it takes for the earth to make a rotation, right? That's how we mark a day, is how long it takes for the earth to spin one time. How long does it take for the same earth as it's spinning to go all the way around the sun? Well, a year, 365 days, plus or minus, with the leap year in there. So we measure time by actually how God created things. It's rooted in the creation order. There's something about all those things that we just recognize that, but that's not true of the seven-day week. That's one of the only ways that we mark time that's not rooted directly in the creation of all things, of the way that things operate. And so you have to realize, like, the idea of 7 days has to be either completely arbitrary, we just decided to make that up as a human race, or somehow God has wired us, he has hardwired us, and he's hardwired the world to work in this 7 day rhythm. That somehow the rhythm of the earth, the rhythm of a 7 day week is rooted in and embedded in us as humans. And as the Judeo-Christian worldview began to proliferate across the globe, the 7 day work week became a universal practice. There are some folks who balked at that and decided we want to change that, and it was disastrous. Back in the 1700s, French Revolution time, the French decided they wanted to have a 10-day work week. Anybody want to sign up for that? So they just changed the calendar, and they decided you're going to work for 10 days, and we'll make that rhythm. And it was a complete disaster. They had suicide rates were up, mental health issues were up, all sorts of different things. It only lasted less than a decade, and then Napoleon came in and took power, and he's like, this is ridiculous. Let's go back to the 7 days. It's happened at different times, but always we come back as a human race to a 7 day rhythm that it seems like God has hardwired into us. So I actually believe that somehow God embedded that idea into us that we work and then we rest. There's this 7 day rhythm. Sabbath is God's gift of grace to us, his gift to all of humanity to step aside from the hectic, kind of inhumane pace that we're prone to live and to rest, to just be human. But then what happens is, as human beings, we're prone to do stuff like this. We take this gift and we turn it into a burden. And that's exactly what happened. The Jewish people who were given this gift of a Sabbath ended up turning it into an obligation. It wasn't a gift anymore. It was the sense of, I've got to do this in order to maintain my righteousness before God. And the logic makes sense, actually, because if work is prohibited on the Sabbath, then by divine command, in order to keep God happy, that's how we would think about it, then I want to define work the best that I can so that I don't do it accidentally and somehow tick off God. And so they created different rules, different regulations, all this sort of stuff that came around the idea of Sabbath. How do we protect ourselves? And it became a burden rather than a gift. And that's what happens when Jesus is on the scene. You hear stories like this multiple times in the New Testament. We just heard a snippet of that read from Mark 2. Jesus is walking on the Sabbath with his disciples, and they're going through a wheat field, and they're picking some grains of wheat, and they're rubbing them together, and they're eating the wheat. And then all of a sudden, the Pharisees, who are the ones who are defining what work looks like, they saw that, and they freaked out, and they reached in their back pocket, and they pulled out the yellow penalty flag, and they threw it on the ground, blew the whistle, and they're like, ah, penalty! Rule number 6, subsection 3.A says no harvesting on the Sabbath. You can't do this. And they completely wigged out. And Jesus, in this passage, is essentially saying, are you serious? Here's the thing. God made the Sabbath for us. He didn't make us so that we would have to keep the Sabbath. The Sabbath was always meant to be a gift, not an obligation. And that just completely wig them out, because Jesus is helping them to understand the real reason that God gave this gift to us. It's a gift, not an obligation. And then time goes on, and unfortunately, the church over the 2,000 years from Jesus' time until ours oftentimes does just as bad a job at managing this gift that's been given to us. You think about, like, back to the Reformation, or even farther back from that, to when the Roman Catholic Church ran the whole show. Sunday was a day of obligation. In lots of countries, if you're a citizen of that country, you have to go to church over this period of time. You have to go to church on Sunday. You can't work. And if you do those things or don't do those things, you break the Sabbath, you would be penalized by law. It's only recently, actually, that things have changed in the last decades, last centuries. So by 2023, we wake up in a culture, if you just woke up today, we've systematically divested ourselves of all of those religious obligations, all of those burdens that were placed on us by the church, the onerous church. We don't have to do anything like that anymore. We are free. We are free to do anything that we want without guilt. And so, listen, do you want to work 7 days a week? Our culture says, go for it. Do you want to buy stuff 7 days a week? Go for it. Do you want to do anything that you want 7 days a week? Absolutely. We're open for business 24/7 or more. We brag about how hard we work. We work so many hours. We bring our work home. We're doing emails on the weekend. We're doing emails at night. We're making calls because it's a global culture. We're making calls, sales calls, early in the morning so we can contact Japan or China or Korea. We're doing it at night. I know you guys are exhausted by this, but we just do this. We have to do it. We're driven by this. If you're younger, you know that you have to have not only your thing, but you have to have a side hustle, because we need to be productive, and we need to find our purpose in life that we can sacrifice everything for, our family, our life, everything, our health. And then we got to document it on social media, because we need to be viewed as successful, because if you're going to do all those things, you got to get credit for it, right? Like, you have to put it out there so the world to see, so that there's this message that you've got to be productive. You've got to be seen, got to be enviable, got to be successful, or you are nothing. And it is killing us. It's killing us. We're arguably the richest, most technologically advanced country in the entire planet. And yet, we have the highest suicide rates, the highest rates of mental illness, highest poverty rates, highest homelessness rates of almost any industrialized nation. We, it turns out, are some of the most dissatisfied and unhappy people on the whole planet. Yay! We win. See, that's why we're spending 4 weeks on the Sabbath. I was joking. I found out from my friend Brian Gregory, who's the pastor at Knox Church in Ann Arbor, a church that we planted, actually, back in the 90s. He and I have lunch together, and I found out they did, like 2 years ago, they did a Sabbath series 26 weeks. And I was laughing at him. I'm like, how did you keep people awake during that whole time? And he said it was wonderful. And then he found out that I was going to do a series, David and I, for 4 weeks. And he just laughed at me. He goes, how are you going to ever, like, explore the riches of the Sabbath in just 4 weeks? But here's the reason we want to do this, is because I know that our culture, and many of us in this room, we are burned out. We are hustling, and we're working it, and you're exhausted. You're here this morning, you're exhausted. You're at the breaking point, and the only reason that we keep trudging on the way that we do is we don't see any other alternative. We ache. We ache in our heart for a rest, a pulling back, renewal. We ache for that in our bones. And here's the crazy part. You want to know the crazy part? Anybody? So first service, I had 3 people ask me if the sermon was going to be short on Memorial Day. I thought, well, that's the crazy part. It actually is, I think. All right, here's the crazy part. Advertisers know that we ache for rest deep in our bones. And so they market to it. They market to it. Just think about this. Here's one of my favorite guys in the whole world up on the screen, Matthew McConaughey. He is so cool. He is so suave. And some brilliant marketers have realized, man, if they put Matthew McConaughey in a Lincoln Navigator, all right, yeah. He is so beautiful. He's such a beautiful man. And he just, his voice is so calming, and he's riding in his Lincoln Navigator. He's going fishing out in some remote region. It's cold. his nose in his hands, it's warm. I so want to be him. I so want that peace. I so want that rest. I so want that just sense of serenity. And so I rush out and I buy a Lincoln Navigator. That's the whole point, right? I don't have one because if I bought a Lincoln Navigator, I would spend even more time trying to pay for the Lincoln Navigator. But they market to that idea. Or maybe it's not Lincoln Navigator for you. Maybe your idea of rest, relaxation, it's the spa life, right? Maybe I'm going to paint a picture for you. Try not to like be so relaxed you fall asleep. But, you know, you go to the spa, and maybe this is your idea of just, like, joy. You go to the spa, and somebody will rub you and spritz you and just wrap you up in soft Egyptian cotton and feed you endless caviar and glasses of wine. Oh, anybody scratching your itch? You're like, yes, I would love that. That would be so amazing. That is exactly what I need. That rest, that relaxation, that peace. I would love that, that serenity. But see, all of that comes at a significant price tag. Why? See, because what we're looking for has been monetized by our culture. They know we want it, and now it's for sale. And so you see what they're trying to sell, though. They're trying to sell us, and there's not evil intent. They're just trying to sell us a time apart from the world where we can enjoy rest. That's actually the definition of a Sabbath. That's what they're selling us. There's something in us that longs for, that just aches for peace and rest, a place apart, a place for true connection with our friends, with our family, with those that we love. And we can't find it because we're told that everything we do is just for sale. We go on extravagant vacations a couple times a year. We go to the lake a couple day weekends multiple times during the summer. We go to the spa, but those things don't have a shelf life, it turns out. It turns out they make us happy. They fill our tank halfway up, maybe you'd say. But it doesn't last. And so we trudge through week after week, yearning and aching for some sort of relief, and it becomes inaccessible because advertisers say you've got to buy it, and we can't buy it. We can't find it. We can't afford it. It's like, anybody a country music fan? There's an old country song, Johnny Lee. He sang this song. You know the song. He says, looking for love in all the wrong places. This is why I don't sing in the choir. Hey, join me. Let's sing it together. Looking for love in all the wrong places. See, we're looking for peace and rest and delight and in all the wrong places. We're looking for it in all these things, all these experiences, all these things that we can buy. And it turns out it's been right there under our noses the whole time that God gave us this gift of Sabbath, that when we practice it, when we open it, and we actually live it, it actually fulfills and it does all that God says that it will do. That's why we're spending a few weeks on this. But here's the natural question. How do we do it? What does it look like? And I want to be super practical with us. For just a few moments as we finish, we'll unpack this some more as we go, but how do we take this spiritual gift from God that has so much promise, Sabbath, a 24-hour period set aside to stop, rest, delight, and worship? The million-dollar question, how do we practice it? I'll give you four ideas. We like to use the phrase daily littles, like things that we can just try it on for size. So number one, pick a time. Pick a Sabbath time, and then just give it a try. You got to make a commitment. If you're going to try this, we got to actually try it. And so there are three kind of essential options. This is what most of us would think. Three different ways of thinking of this. One is to say, well, I'm going to do it on a Sunday. If I want to try this, it makes sense. You're here today. You woke up this morning. You decide, I'm going to come to worship. And we worship together, and we sing, or we listen to the songs being sung. And that's a great start. And so maybe Sunday is a day for you to have your Sabbath. That actually doesn't work for me, because believe it or not, I kind of work on Sundays. Now, it's the only day that I work. One pastor I heard of, he said, I only work on Sunday, and I complain the rest of the days of the week about that one day. That's not me. But So Sunday doesn't work so well for me. I love worshiping together, but I get anxious and all sorts of things. So a second option for those whose schedules don't permit us to work to have a Sabbath on Sunday is to say, well, maybe the Jewish option. Typically, this was practiced by Jews and still is today. You start Friday at sundown because in biblical theology, the day actually starts at sundown. It doesn't start in the morning when you wake up. It starts at sundown. And so people would, oftentimes you shut down all the stuff. You begin your Sabbath. I'll give you some practices to start. But one is maybe lighting a candle just to begin the day. And then have a dinner together. Have dinner together as a family, or maybe it's your small group. It's just the celebration at the beginning of a day. And then there's an evening, and you're trying to play games with the family and not just turn on the TV and pour yourself a drink or something like that, because that's not restful. And then have a wonderful night's sleep. Wake up in the morning. Spend some time with the Lord. Allow the day to unfold a little bit more naturally. That's a great way. Whether you pick a Sunday, Saturday, whatever, or even a day in the middle of the week. Because I know lots of us in the medical profession and different professions, like Sunday doesn't work, Saturday doesn't work, but maybe Thursday or a Tuesday. So for me, Thursday night is what I try to take my Sabbath. And believe it or not, I, as your pastor, have only begun that practice about 2.5 years ago. Sabbath is different than a day off. It's different than a day off where you just do all the rest of your work and be productive in other ways. It's a day of resting. Pick a time and give it a try. And then second, start small. Start small. Start where you are, not where you think you should be. Or as one of my pastoral mentors says, do what you can, not what you can't. If you're hearing me say 24 hours and you're thinking, there is no chance that I could take 24 hours. I can't even imagine given my schedule. Then take a half a day. Take 8 hours. Take 4 hours, whatever it is. Here's the deal. I don't know your life. You might have a bunch of young school-age kids at home, and you're thinking, I would love to have a Sabbath. You're speaking my love language, but I have no idea where I would start. Maybe a win for you is just to say, hey, for these 3 hours, let's have a family Sabbath time together. Let's do some stuff together. And then you trade off and on with your spouse. You say, you give me 3 hours where I can suspend in some great productive spiritual ways, or unproductive, as the case may be. And then I'll trade. And then you take 3 hours. Whatever it is, I'm just asking you to start. Start small. Start wherever you can. You might be working 2 jobs trying to make ends meet, and you think, I don't know how I would do this. Sabbath is maybe a couple hours just chiseled out of your week. Jesus said these great words. Sabbath is made for you. You're not made to be obligated to keep the Sabbath. This is a gift. So pick a time and start, but start small. And then third, think subtraction, not addition. Think subtraction, not addition. Remember, Sabbath is a 24-hour period set aside to stop, rest, delight, and worship. So don't feel like you have to add a Sabbath to your already overbusy, overburdened life. Think this way. What can I cut out? Is it answering all my emails on my Sabbath? Is it watching television shows that are fun, but they don't actually relax you? You know this. You're done watching those shows. You don't feel more relaxed. You just feel like you numbed, if you don't like that word, then distracted yourself from reality for the time that you watch that. And nothing is more important for us as modern people if we're going to subtract something than unplugging from our devices. Now, you're going to freak out. You're freaking out already, I can tell. This little guy that I carry, I thought the first service, I didn't have this in my pocket, and I thought, I feel naked. I don't know. But that's because I didn't have this. So here's the thing. All of us, we've become addicted to these little guys. Anybody? It's our computer. It's our device, whatever. Because we think to ourselves, I've got to have this. I've got to be plugged in. I've got to have 24-hour access to news. Because what if I didn't know the score of the Boston Celtics game last night? What if I didn't know? It'd be terrible. So I look. Don't look. We think to ourselves, if I don't have my device on me, then what if there's an emergency? Nobody will be able to get a hold of me. The reality is we are 100% addicted to these because the people who made these devices and all the apps and everything else are geniuses. They've designed it No, I don't think with ill intent, but they've designed it so that you feel like you have to answer every text right away. You feel like you have to be checking for email all the time. You have to be checking the news, whatever the news is that you love. It's sports news, it's political news, it's whatever. We all feel this way. I fall into the same trap. I wake up in the morning, the first thing that I do is pick up my phone. You do the same thing. Or maybe you go to the bathroom first and then you pick up your phone. Every single one of us. So the idea that we need to unplug in order to give ourselves space mentally to be able to connect with God and with others and even with our own hearts and our own thoughts, it is anathema to us. I can tell that you are skeptical that unplugging is possible because you think, if I don't have this device open and on all the time, I will die. And I guarantee you, I promise you, you will not die. I promise you, well, you might die, but it won't be because of that, right? Can we unplug and actually connect with other human beings, connect with our own emotions, connect with our thoughts, connect with God? Unplugging from our devices, one of the best things that we could possibly do. And it doesn't take you any extra time. But I know you're freaking out about it, just thinking about it. I can't do that for 24 hours. Well, do it for 8, do it for 4, do it for 3. Do as you can, not as you can't. Amen? Like nobody wants to say amen, because amen says I agree with you. Because here's ultimately the reality, is that unplugging from our stuff, pulling back from our work, trying not to be productive on those days, not get our to-do list done, it requires a ton of trust of God. Because what we're doing is we're saying, God, I trust you for these 24 hours to actually run the universe without me. Because in our heart of hearts, we think to ourselves, I know, if I don't, it won't. And we can't trust God, but can we trust God that if we don't do for these 24 hours, God actually is capable of running the universe? It seems like when I say it like that, you think, well, of course he can, but we don't actually believe it in our hearts. It takes a lot of trust. So start small, think subtraction, not addition. And then here's the last one. Pick some Sabbath activities and just give it a run. Give it a try. I'm going to put up a QR code up on the screen. John Mark Comer, I mentioned his name before. He was a pastor out in West Coast. He stepped back from that, and he runs an organization called Practicing the Way. He's done some brilliant writing and thinking about different spiritual practices, and Sabbath is one of those. And so I'm going to give you permission to use your devices right now. I just told you to turn them off. You can turn them on. If you know how to work this, right? You put it on camera mode, point it up at that squiggly thing, that QR code, and it'll say on your phone, do you want to go to this website? And you click on that website, it'll take you to a free download of a PDF. It's about a 40-page thing that helps you to see some different ideas for how to do a Sabbath. How do you do this with your family? What are some things you could stop doing? What are some things you can start doing? How does this work? It's actually brilliantly done. I really encourage you to spend some time. We'll put this up later so you can do it if you miss it now. But download that, save it, look at it later. It's awesome stuff. It gives you tons of ideas. If I'm going to stop for 4 hours, 8 hours, 24 hours, what do I do? Hope this ends soon. It'll give you some really practical suggestions, like some I gave you before. Maybe start with lighting a candle just to symbolize the start of a Sabbath. Have dinner together. Enjoy a good book. Like it doesn't have to be quote-unquote spiritual things. One of the things I've done in my Sabbath over these months is read through the Lord of the Rings trilogy. It's going to take me about 6 years. Because every underside of every leaf and the path, it's just like crazy. But I love doing it. I just sit back with my Kindle and read for half hour, 45 minutes until I fall asleep. And taking a nap on the Sabbath is a wonderful activity to do. You're just resting in God. Play a game. Pick up a hobby that you haven't done for a long time. Spend some extra time with God. That's what I love to do in the mornings of a Sabbath, is I just spend a lot of extra time in my walk with God. I'm so much more creative. God gives me so many more ideas when I'm not trying to think of ideas. I'm just allowing God to rest in God and allow him to speak in different ways. One of the greatest ideas, Comer mentioned this in this deal here, an idea for the Sabbath. I saw it in a couple different resources, so I actually believe this is true. The rabbis, the Jewish rabbis back in the day said one of the greatest Sabbath activities that you could do if you're married is make love with your spouse. I love Sabbath. Sabbath is, come on, anybody? It's so practical, so awesome. Just like the love that God has for us. He gives us this gift. So, I just know, every activity that you try to start, the hardest part is just getting going. And so I'm trying to give you as many ideas as I can to make it simple. I want it to be a gift to you. It's not an obligation. I want you to give it a try. And when you fail, because I do this and I fail often, I don't get to spend a whole 24 hours or even 8 sometimes, or I pull out my phone and I just can't stop doing it. I give myself grace because this is a gift for us. It's not meant to be an obligation. It's not meant to make you feel guilty. It's meant to be an absolute gift for you. And so as you do this, I'll give you 3 questions to reflect on. As you think about this message, here's 3 questions I want you to think about. They'll be all up on the screen for a second. There you go. How does the idea of Sabbath strike you? So you've been hearing me talk about this today. How does that strike you? Does it excite you? You're like, this is awesome. I would love to be able to do this. Or does it fill you with dread? Or do you get angry? How is it? How does it strike you and why? Think about that one for a moment. And then second, do you already practice the Sabbath? If you do, how do you do that? When do you do that? I'm just kind of curious. And if you don't, if you tried it, when would you try to do it? And how would you try to do that? And then, excuse me, third, what would you need to do today to decide to start? Like if you wanted to start today, what would you do? What's the first step? Maybe the first step is just downloading this PDF that I put up on the screen a second ago. Now, I'm gonna tweak you a little bit. I don't hardly ever do this. So if you come, it's your first time here, I'm sorry. You come back again next week, it won't happen, most likely. But I'm going to ask you in a moment to talk about this together, to get a person or 2 people around you and just talk about those 3 questions. There's no right answer. There's no wrong answer. I want you to reflect on those together, and it'll be for about 3 minutes, and the worship team will start to sing, and then we'll sing a last song. So introverts, don't panic. It's only 3 minutes long. You don't need therapy right now. Extroverts, you've got to stop after 3 minutes. But here's what I want you to do is, in a moment, I'm going to ask you to get up and talk with somebody or a couple somebodies that you don't live with and you didn't come here with. You don't live with them and you didn't come here with them. You've got to meet somebody else. And here's a secret. Here's something really cool. I asked the ushers before the service to take all of the glue off the seats. So there's no glue on any of your seats. It won't hold you down. So I want you to be able to get up, talk to somebody or a couple somebodies that you didn't come with and that you don't live with, and just reflect on those 3 questions. It could be a really short conversation. You could say, I hated it, I'm never going to do it. And it's over, right? Somebody else might talk and they'll fill the space. So 3 minutes, go. And then when the music starts, we'll sing. All right? You got this. You can do this.
How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
So, how did this strike you?
Reminded me of all the things I have to do today. What about you?
Songs. Such good songs.
Yeah.
I started keeping bees.
Oh, really?
Check out my bees.
Where are they at?
In my backyard. I got three hives right now.
Wow. Making honey?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. 50 pounds last year.
50 pounds?
Yeah. Out of one hive, so. That's I'm up for, gets me away from work.
Yeah. My wife says I have too many hives. Maybe that's part of the takeaway.
Oh, praise the Father, praise the
I hope today as you leave that you are absolutely filled up, that you are encouraged, that you would want to receive the gift of Sabbath. Open it up. Give it a try. We're learning together. Come back next week and we'll find out a little bit more about the value of this incredible gift and what it can do for us. So as you leave today, I want to give you a blessing. If you want to raise your hands, lift your hearts, lift your eyes. May you go in the grace, in the peace, in the love, and the rest of a great Savior. Amen and amen. Have a great Memorial Day, everybody.
I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same. Prayers back then, and you will answer.